Welcome to the Find Your Feminine Fire podcast. I'm your host, renowned sex and relationship coach, Amanda Testa. And if you are looking to reclaim your sexual desire, take sex from a to-do to something you look forward to, and enjoy deeply connected relationships without adding more to your already full plate, then you are in the right place. Listen in to discover how to fan the flames of your feminine fire, fall in love with your sensual self again, and experience intimacy like never before, all in a way that feels really good to your system. Make yourself comfortable and enjoy the episode. What if some of the biggest blocks to experiencing mind-blowing pleasure and deep connection aren't about technique, toys, skills, your partner, but are actually rooted in the quiet, persistent, quote, good girl messages you've been conditioned to believe? This episode is all about good girl conditioning, people-pleasing, those messages telling you to be likable, accommodating, and good. We'll explore how this conditioning seeps into your relationships and intimate life, disconnecting you from authentic pleasure and keeping you in patterns of people-pleasing and self-censorship. If you are ready to let go of the good girl conditioning that's keeping you small and reclaim a deeper sense of confidence and pleasure, stick around. Let's dive in. Let's start with the basics. What is good girl conditioning? It is a social and cultural programming. Conditioning refers to the process by which behaviors, beliefs, and habits are instilled and reinforced through repeated experiences, often beginning in childhood. This can be through explicit teachings, for example, good girls don't make a fuss, or more subtle cues, for example, receiving praise for being quiet and compliant. I know when I was growing up, one of the famous quotes was, children should be seen and not heard. And over time, these repeated messages shape how a person views themselves in the world, affecting our behaviors and responses, sometimes unconsciously, often unconsciously. And you might hear a lot about conditioning, so you might be wondering, what does that mean? So that's kind of why I'm explaining it. And there's a couple of types of conditioning. Number one is a conditioning that where an emotion or a reaction is associated with a specific event. For example, if you as a child only received love and attention when you behaved, quote, properly, then you might grow up associating compliance with affection and safety. The other is operant conditioning. For example, if behaviors were reinforced through rewards or consequences, for example, if speaking up or expressing anger is met with disapproval or punishment, a child learns to suppress those reactions to avoid negative outcomes. I remember we always had a joke coming along when we were at church as kids. I was raised in South Georgia in Southern Baptist religion. And I remember anytime we would be acting up in church, my mother would come over and give us a hug, pretending like giving us a hug, but then like be poking us with her fingernails to behave ourselves. But from a young age, this is very common in our culture. From a young age, many of us are taught to be compliant and nurturing and likable and to put others' needs and comfort above our own. I was raised, like I said, a Southern belle, and I was raised with very clear messages about what it meant to be good. I learned to be polite, to avoid saying anything that might disrupt, and to look pretty, but never too bold. And this is where that people-pleasing habit is born. Maybe you can relate to that. I've spent, since I was 18, trying to deprogram myself for so much of that messaging that I grew up with. Because for me, it resulted in a lot of challenges and problems. For example, eating disorders, alcohol abuse, all kinds of things, because I felt like I was just not truly myself. I did not know how to be myself. Good girl conditioning teaches us that our worth lies in making others happy, being non-confrontational, playing small, essentially. And we absorb these beliefs through our families, schools, media, society. So when I say conditioning, I'm talking about those behaviors and beliefs that were drilled into us as survival strategies, patterns that helped us gain approval, acceptance, and maybe even love. Here are some very common elements of this quote unquote good girl conditioning. Number one is prioritizing others, as I mentioned. So this is putting everyone else's needs and comfort first, often at the expense of our own desires and boundaries. I hear this a lot from my clients who are very busy with successful businesses and families and caregiving and all the things and doing such a good job of taking care of everyone and everything except themselves. Avoiding conflict. This is, again, being encouraged to maintain harmony above all else, especially if it means avoiding difficult conversations or sacrificing your true feelings. For many of these people, it's too hard to really get into the fight. They would just, you know, avoid just to keep things harmonious even if they are not allowing themselves to be true, trying to seek approval, being in line with others, what others expect, tying our self-worth to praise, validation, or acceptance, and diminishing our own needs. To remain good, we are taught to avoid being too bold, outspoken, or assertive, especially when it can make others uncomfortable, and suppressing our authenticity. We mask our true selves, emotion, and desires as being too direct, passionate, or strong-willed because this can be seen as rebellious or, quote, bad, right? Which leads to people-pleasing, self-silencing, and over time, again, an over-reliance on external validation, which makes it really hard to assert what we need, express our boundaries, or explore our authentic desires. And in intimate relationships and in the bedroom, this often shows up as holding back our true wants, fearing rejection, or performing a version of pleasure that pleases a partner rather than genuinely fulfilling oneself. So I want you to move from faking it to feeling it, my friends. And I want to just talk about the nervous system perspective of this. Being that a lot of my work involves somatic experiencing, from a nervous system perspective, this is how it can really hold us back. Because this can often create a form of low-level survival response. When we are young, we, again, by nature, we are highly attuned to the cues and reactions of our caregivers and the environment. If we receive messages, either directly or indirectly, that our worth depends on being quiet, compliant, or good, our nervous system learns to prioritize safety through compliance. And this is an ingrained survival strategy that places the nervous system in a subtle but constant state of vigilance. For example, when we suppress our true feelings or refrain from expressing our needs or prioritize others' comfort above our own, our nervous system can get caught in a freeze response. This pattern of self-silencing then can become a habit as the body learns to adapt social expectations by keeping emotions contained and avoiding behaviors that might lead to disapproval or conflict. So in somatic experiencing terms, people-pleasing aligns with the freeze or fawn response. These are biological mechanisms that help us avoid conflict, maintain social harmony when we feel unsafe. When you are people-pleasing, you're not consciously choosing to do so. Your nervous system is seeking safety through social appeasement. This is a deeply embedded survival response, one that prioritizes maintaining connection and avoiding perceived threats. But over time, this response can leave you feeling disconnected from your authentic self. It prevents the nervous system from returning to a relaxed parasympathetic state. And instead, the body remains in a low-level survival mode, which really inhibits our ability to fully engage in pleasure, creativity, and self-expression. And this doesn't just affect how we show up at work or in our friendships, it affects how we experience our bodies and sexuality and our relationships. So how does it show up in the bedroom? This looks like saying yes when you mean no. This might look like agreeing to intimacy when you're not truly in the mood. And this is a pattern. If this becomes a pattern over years, you may also experience pain during sex, numbness, et cetera. So even if you're in a loving partnership, when you don't honor your body's needs of a yes or a no, and when we feel that yes, it's like we're moving towards something. We really want it. We can feel it. So I like to give the example of if you are someone who loves chocolate cake, for example, and maybe if you're gluten-free, it's like a tort. So you see this chocolate cake and you're so excited to treat yourself. It's your birthday. You're going to indulge in a little celebration and you see the cake and you're like salivating for it and you're leaning towards it and you can't wait to take a bite. That is your body like leaning towards, right? Now, say, for example, this is like an expired moldy meal from 2 weeks ago and you're like cleaning out the fridge and you're like, oh, and then when you open the Tupperware, it smells so bad and you're like, oh, and you push yourself far away from it. Right? That's how our body reacts. And this is an extreme example, but this is subtle as well, right? So if your body is constantly wanting to move away from something, but you force it to lean in against its will over time, this can actually, your body can digest that as a bit of a trauma response. Okay. This also looks like prioritizing your partner's pleasure over your own. This is so common for so many women who feel like it's their job to make sure their partner is happy, even if they're not fully satisfied. So this looks like faking orgasms. This looks like not letting yourself speak your needs. This could look like feeling guilty for taking too long to orgasm. So many women feel rushed or pressured to perform, even feeling guilty for enjoying themselves. Self-silencing is another way this shows up. You may find yourself holding back natural sounds or movements, worried about being too much. This is such a common thing I see in so many women I work with, the not being able to express, not being able to make sounds for fear of someone hearing, kids around, you know, there's a time and a place for all of that. But also there needs to be a time and a place for you to fully let loose, because when you are truly in the throes of intimacy and your natural primal sexual enjoyment, it doesn't look pretty. Often it does not look pretty at all. It does not look like what you see on TV or porn. And so that's one of the things when we really are embracing our wild nature, this wild part of us, it's not about doing it from a place of rebellion. It's about doing it from a place of authenticity and truth and like really allowing your primal nature to emerge without worrying about what it looks like, without worrying about being too much. And again, also that feeling or need to be smaller or prettier or easy to handle, like not standing out. And some places they call it the tall poppy syndrome, where you just are keeping yourself small to stay in line, not make anyone feel bad. And there's been a recent study where self-silencing behaviors in bed are linked to lower sexual satisfaction. Of course, when we stay quiet, when we keep our preferences hidden and perform rather than experience pleasure, we disconnect from ourselves and our partners. And how else does this show up in the body? Good girl conditioning often triggers a freeze response, a survival strategy where we shut down or go still to avoid perceived threats. In the bedroom, this freeze response shows up in ways that block authentic pleasure. This can look like feeling numb or disconnected from sensation. You might notice that instead of feeling every sensation, you're tuning out or just going through the motions. Individuals in a freeze state may feel numb, detached, or disconnected from their own body sensations. This can make it challenging to feel pleasure, as the body is not fully engaged in the experience. People may report feeling blank or like they're watching from the outside, dissociated, unable to be fully present in the moment. Being unable to communicate your needs, this also can make it hard to speak up, so you stay silent or go along to avoid discomfort. In a freeze state, verbal communication becomes difficult. It leaves you unable to express your needs, boundaries, or desires. It can also feel like being frozen in place, or speaking up might feel impossible or even unsafe. Perhaps you go along with an experience rather than risk conflict or disappointment by asking for adjustments, creating a passive dynamic rather than a mutually engaged one. You might feel physical tension, right? There could be tightness. There could be pain. There could be tightness in your shoulders, jaw, or pelvis. That's signs of bracing that keep you from fully letting go. Your body may feel tense. You know, this could be your gut. In essence, your muscles are guarded. It restricts relaxation and can inhibit the body's natural rhythms, makes it really difficult to open up physically to a partner or to experience arousal. And it shows up a lot like in the shoulders, the pelvis, the jaw, creating physical barriers to pleasure. This is the pain, you know, and in a recent study, 1 in 3 women experienced pain with intercourse, and that's only one way to have sex. So I say that, but often for many listening who are in heterosexual relationships, or if there's any kind of penetrative sex of any kind with a toy, with a strap on, whatever, there's pain. Okay, so that is what that can look like. When we hold back our natural responses is another way this shows up. Not being able to make sounds, not moving or emotion, you know, suppressing those authentic reactions, that response of freeze blocks the full spectrum of pleasure. We can hold back vocalizations, movements, or other natural expressions of pleasure, feeling as though we need to keep control or avoid fully letting go. This is a big part of not being able to surrender, not being able to enjoy the higher levels of pleasure. And again, it's self-censorship that's often rooted in deep-seated fear of being judged, making mistakes, appearing too much, which prevents that organic release needed for satisfying intimacy. Now, I want to just talk a little bit more about this, because so often when I work with clients, these are some of the symptoms that they report. You know, like they're just going through the motions. They're really disengaged when you feel that sense of obligation or pressure to perform, right? A lot of times I hear my clients say, God, it just feels like a task on my list and I just don't even enjoy it. And as Emily Nagoski said on the podcast last week, it is not a dysfunction and is not wrong to want to have sex that we do not enjoy. So we often have to take a step back and learn to enjoy, you know, change the aspects so we're actually enjoying it, right? And if we have difficulty with arousal or orgasm, so often I hear from clients, you know, they can feel pleasure, but then it just kind of stops. Or they're not able to surrender into the orgasm, or they're not able to let go. They're not able to get out of their head and get into their body. So, you know, when our nervous system is in a state of low-level vigilance, that will directly inhibit our arousal and the body's ability to relax into pleasure. Because when our nervous system is on guard, the body cannot fully enter that parasympathetic state required for deeper pleasure and orgasm.
Hey, it's Amanda. If you are enjoying the show and felt a connection to what we've discussed, and you're ready to take the next step in reigniting your passion and enhancing your relationships, I have something special for you. Visit www.amandatesta.com/thegoods where you can subscribe to my email. And if you want, you can sign up for a free personalized sensuality rediscovery session with me. In this one-on-one heart-to-heart session, we'll explore your unique desires, uncover any challenges, and set a path for you to experience the vibrant, fulfilling love life you deserve. Don't let another day pass feeling unfulfilled or disconnection. Take action now and let's start this beautiful journey together to fire up your feminine fire. Join me at amandatesta.com/thegoods. I'm excited to stay connected. Now back to the show. So neuroscience shows us that deep pleasure requires a relaxed parasympathetic state. But when we're in people-pleasing mode or freeze mode, if our body is subtly on guard, then of course, it's going to be challenging. So if you are someone who has trouble getting out of your head during sex, this might be at play. Now, what do we do about this? Okay, what do we do? How do we reclaim our pleasure and power? Let's talk about ways to start breaking free from this good girl trap. And, you know, I want to just share a little bit more about why you might want this, right? How you can start to reclaim your authentic power and pleasure. We really have to, number one, create a state of safety. Now, again, this takes time and effort, and this is a lot of the time the base level work I do with clients, specifically with somatic experiencing and, you know, working with the nervous system, because we need to find that state of safety and a safe enough experience within our bodies, right? We are never going to be 100% safe, but like a safe enough in the moment experience. And when we, you know, when we're braced or when we're suppressing our impulses, we're not going to be able to let go. So we need to create that uninhibited pleasure by allowing our body to feel safe, free from pressure, move and express freely. And people pleasing does not support us in that. So a lot of the time, this work can be best done like with yourself first, so that you can feel comfortable on your own and then bringing it into your relationship with your partner. So sometimes one of the great things I love to do is, you know, if you're moving into an experience, start to loosen up your body, you know, have a period of transition. Sometimes it can be helpful. Like if you do want to connect with your partner and you do want to find ways to enjoy more intimacy, but it feels challenging, you know, maybe just giving yourself a ritual of transition of some sort. Perhaps you go into the bathroom and do a little shaking exercise. I really love shaking or moving the body because sometimes that just helps to release tension from our habitual behaviors. It can invite in different movement, moving our body in ways that we don't typically do, like kind of getting out of those held somatic patterns. So this can look like, you know, maybe just go in the bathroom and a little shake and wiggle for just 2 minutes, something like that. Another practice that can really help you here is learning to tune into your body's sensations. I talk about this a lot on the podcast. This is a process of interoception, which basically means listening to your body's cues. Do you notice the sensations you feel in your body, right? It could be when you feel cold or when you feel hot, or if there's a sensation of pleasure or a pleasant sensation or a painful sensation, or, you know, even numbness is a sensation. And we can start to observe these sensations without judgment. And then that gives you a greater tolerance for just simply being aware of your somatic experience. So one of the great practices I love around this is a body meditation. So what is a body meditation? That is simply you give yourself a few minutes. I sometimes like to do it before I go to bed or when I wake up or just if I have a minute. And I just will start to pay attention to what I notice. So you can like start at the top of your head and just slowly scan through your body and just name out loud what you notice, right? It's just being curious. And what this will do, well, it helps to start to connect that witness in you where you're like, oh, I can witness that I'm having a twitch in my right eye. And it disconnects you from being so wrapped up in the experience of it, but you can just name it from a curious place. So I can give you a quick example right now. So if I'm just kind of noticing what's happening in my head as I start to work my way down, I do notice I have a little bit of a twitch in my right eye. I'm noticing a little bit of tension in my jaw. I'm noticing that I feel hot in my chest. I'm going to take my jacket off. I feel like I'm too hot, right? I just, as I notice it from space to space, I just kind of notice what I'm feeling and name it out loud, right? As I'm letting that awareness move down my arms, I feel kind of a little bit of a tingling in my arms and hands. I feel like a heaviness in my sit bones. It feels very grounded and heavy. I feel kind of like a warmth sensation in my chest.
And as I pay attention to it, it feels like it's kind of expanding through my torso. That is an example of a body meditation. And it can take time. This is like learning a new language for many people. So just be patient with yourself if this is new, because it is like learning a new language. Another big part of this is being able to create boundaries. Practicing physical and emotional boundaries within the body really helps here. Practicing saying no when it feels safe to do so and noticing how that registers in the body. Noticing when it might feel hard. You know, I did a podcast a few weeks ago all around boundaries, which goes deeper here, but this is such a key thing of just being able to start to speak your needs and tuning in. What are the things that I want? What do I want to experience? Can I name those things? Right? And really giving yourself the opportunity to tune in. What do I want? I love that practice of making a list of all the things I desire. I do it on a regular basis because it changes constantly. And it's a good way to stay tuned in. Like, what are the things that are lighting you up? I want to talk a little bit about how you talk to your partner about this, because when we want to reclaim our pleasure, having these realizations are powerful, and it is something you can share with your partner. So I want to give you some ideas and some scripts around chatting with them about this, because you have to talk about it. And a supportive partner will understand that you are wanting to prioritize your authenticity most of the time. And I will tell you, your partner wants you to be happy. 9 times out of 10, they want to please you. And this can be incredibly freeing for both of you to have these deeper conversations. So a few things to keep in mind when you want to have a conversation like this is you want to choose the right time. Finding a moment when you're both relaxed and open, not in the heat of the moment or right before bed, setting aside intentional time for this type of conversation can really make it feel more comfortable and safe. You know, and you can even just go to them and be like, you know, when is a good time to have a conversation? I'd love to be able to chat. And that way you let them know, let your partner know. You could just say, this is a bit vulnerable for me to share, but it feels important. I trust you with this, and I'd love your support as I practice. This lets your partner see your openness and helps create a safe space for both of you to explore together. Also, you can ask what they think would be an idea, right? This is a conversation, it's a co-creation, so they might have ideas of how they can help you as well. And by opening up these kind of conversations, you're creating a space where you can both express your true needs. You know, you have to be able to have these conversations, leading to a more fulfilled, connected, and pleasurable relationship. And it's not about fixing or changing anything. It's about inviting each other into a deeper level of trust, vulnerability, and enjoyment. With every conversation like this, you're stepping closer to a relationship where both of you feel seen, heard, and honored. That is the beauty of reclaiming your pleasure and sharing it authentically with a partner. It has the power to bring you closure and enrich every part of your relationship. And, you know, this is why I want to give you scripts, because it can't always be easy. So maybe you even say something like, I realized I've been holding back in certain ways, and I'd love to start expressing more of my needs. Would you be open to exploring this with me? A supportive partner will understand that you are prioritizing authenticity, and these conversations can open doors to a more fulfilling, connected relationship. And again, if you need help with this, you can always reach out. And those kind of invitations can be gentle but direct, right? That also, again, allows your partner to see this isn't about blaming or fixing, but it's enhancing the relationship by bringing more authenticity and pleasure to it. I'm going to give you a few more examples here, because I love concrete examples and scripts to help you. You might say, if you want to share your intentions around this, you might say something like, I've been reflecting on how I show up in our intimate moments, and I'm realizing that I often worry about what you're feeling more than focusing on my own experience. I'd love to start sharing what I'm feeling and needing so that I can be fully present with you. What are your thoughts around that? Right? This approach invites your partner to join you in a new way of connecting, letting them know that this shift is about creating more presence and pleasure for the both of you. Maybe you want to express a desire to slow down, because this is a huge part of it. So often we're rushing through our experiences. And often when we slow down and are really able to tune into what we're noticing, the sensations we're feeling, what we like, what we don't, this can be a game changer. So you could say, I'd love to experiment with slowing things down so I can really tune into my body. It would mean so much to me if we could create space for this. I feel like it would help me connect more deeply with you and with myself. This example expresses your need without making demands. You're sharing a desire to be more in tune, which gives your partner a concrete way to support you in feeling safe and connected. Giving those concrete things are very helpful. You could also ask for feedback and openness, right? I'm learning that expressing myself more authentically is really important for me, but it's still new and I'm nervous about it. I'd love to create a space where I can share openly.
And would you let me know how it feels for you too? Right? That's kind of creating that base of safety. This approach not only lets your partner know what you need, but it also opens the door for them to share their feelings, creating a two-way conversation and building trust. And maybe there's specific boundaries you want to address or specific requests. There's a specific boundary you want to set. You could say something like, I'd love to try focusing on different ways of connecting intimately. Right now, I feel most comfortable exploring without the pressure of a particular outcome. How would you feel about focusing more on touch, eye contact, and just being present together? That way you can share that concrete boundary, but framing it as an exploration you want to enjoy together, which can feel like a positive and exciting shift for both partners. When you can take that goal of orgasm off the table, there's so much freedom that can come from that. There's a lot of pressure often that women feel or that people feel in relationships around having an orgasm. And that can, again, lead to taking away from the pleasure. And also, if you want to be more curious about pleasure, if that's something you want to explore more, you could say, I'm discovering that there is so much more to pleasure than I realized. I'd love to explore this with you. What if we both shared a few things we've been curious to try? And we can take it slow and see what feels good for both of us. This, again, invites your partner to be part of the process of discovery, making it feel collaborative and fun rather than intimidating. And also, sometimes, again, that vulnerability piece, opening up about people-pleasing habits. And if this has been part of your experience, you could just say, I realize I sometimes go along with things out of habit, and I really want to show up more authentically with you and to deepen our connection. Would you be open to checking in more about what feels good for both of us? This is that vulnerable piece that lets your partner know that you're working to be more present and authentic, and that supporting you by checking in can help you both experience more satisfaction. I mean, if you think about it, when you go get a massage, they're always like, how's the pressure? You know, how does this feel? And then you can sell or say what you like. And this is a good place to practice that type of thing too, you know? Sometimes it can, again, you can feel that freeze or please response come in and you don't want to speak up. This can be a place to practice. So again, some of the things that we want to practice are, you know, simple grounding exercises can be so helpful. Being able to communicate with our partner more, doing our own practices. Again, this is why I love teaching pleasure practices to my clients, because when we learn these our own tools and we can express our own body in our own space, we can release these old patterns of freeze, of people-pleasing, and cultivate resilience, enabling fuller participation and enjoyment in our sex lives. So as we keep doing these practices, our nervous system begins to understand that it's safe to express, safe to say no, and safe to ask for what you truly want. And this practice restores your ability to engage in relationships in your own body from a place of office with of more authenticity, trust, and ease. And so I know this is a lot, so take a moment. And just if it feels good to you, take a deep breath and maybe just noticing what it might feel like to just invite in a little more authenticity and pleasure. Right? This is something we can all do. And through this podcast today, you know, my goal is to really try to educate you and help us to understand a little bit more about what is that good girl conditioning? How is it holding us back? What we can do about it? How we can communicate with our partners about it? And maybe some simple practices we could try to feel more in tune with our bodies and to feel more connected with ourselves. And if this all resonates with you and you are ready to start letting go of that good girl pattern that's holding you back, I've got something special for you. You can download my Good Girl Graveyard Ritual, which is a playful yet powerful ceremony designed to help you release those old, outdated habits, reconnect with your authentic self, and invite more pleasure and freedom into your life. So if you're ready to bury the good girl and let your wild, true self rise, you can go to amandatesta.com/good-girl. Again, that's amandatesta.com/good-girl. And we can start this journey towards your full, unapologetic power together. Time to have some fun, reclaim your magic, and create the connection and pleasure you deserve. And always, if you're ready for more personalized support, you can always book a call with me to find the right step for you. Thank you so much again for being here. Remember, your pleasure is your birthright, and embracing it is a beautiful rebellion against that good girl conditioning that no longer serves you. Until next time, keep stoking that fire within you. Thank you for listening, and we will see you next week.
Thank you for listening to the Find Your Feminine Fire podcast. If you loved this episode, please go ahead and forward it right now to someone you know would love it. And if you've not had a chance yet to leave us a rave review on Apple Podcasts, please make sure to rate and review if you enjoyed it, as well as make sure to subscribe so you never miss an episode. Want to stay connected? Make sure to go to amandatesta.com/thegoods to download your free sensuality activation and stay connected. Thanks for listening, and we'll see you next week.